Continuing with the second chapter, Historiography, Indian Tradition, now we'll move on to the historiography in the post-independence era. We will continue from page number 11, Historiography in the post-independence era. Now, along with writing the dynastic histories, the cultural, social, economic histories were also being written. Scholars of the post-independence era began to feel the need of writing histories of various communities, sciences, economic systems, political ideologies, cultural aspects, etc. The historiography of this era has been influenced mainly by three ideological schools: Marxist history, subaltern history, and feminist history. So here we will see that in the post-independence era, the perspective of historiography or history went on increasing, and at the beginning we had seen it was only confined to the kings and their wars and that stuff, but later on it went on increasing, and by the time it reached the post-independence era, by that time the writings included dynastic history, the cultural, social, economic histories were also written. And in the post-independence era, we see that histories were written on various communities, sciences, social, economic systems, political ideologies, cultural aspects, etc. So on all these topics also history was written. The historiography of this era, that is the post-independence era, was influenced by mainly by three ideological schools. Ideological is a set of belief. These schools had a set of belief, and there were three such beliefs. One was the Marxist history, the other was the subaltern history, and the third was the feminist history. First, we will see the Marxist history. The concern for the means of production, modes of production, and the industrial relations were at the center in the writings of Marxist historians. Accordingly, to analyze the impact of every social event of significance has remained the basic theme of Marxist historiography. Now, in this Marxist historiography, the ideology was mainly based on the production. So, the means of production, that is the raw materials and all that stuff, modes of production, how it was produced, and the industrial relations were at the center in the writings of Marxist historiography. So, more focus or main emphasis was given on the means of production, modes of production, and the industrial relations. Accordingly, to analyze the impact of every social event of significance has remained the basic theme. So what was the impact of every social event? So that was the main that remained as the basic theme of the Marxist historiography. Marxist historians in India studied the transition within the caste system. Among the notable Indian historians who adopted Marxist ideological framework, scholars like Damodar Dharmananda Kosambi, Comrade Shripath Amrut Dange, Ram Charan Sharma, Comrade Sharad Patil have contributed notably. Comrade Dange was one of the founder members of the Indian Communist Party. Primitive Communism to Slavery, the book written by him, represents Marxist historiography. So now Marxist historians in India, they studied the transitions within the caste system. How there was a change and development in the caste system that they studied, and the notable Indian historians who adopted, who followed the Marxist ideological framework were scholars like Damodar Dharmananda Kosambi, Comrade Shripad Amrut Dange, Ram Charan Sharma, Comrade Sharad Patil, and all these people have contributed to the Marxist historiography, and their contribution was notable. Comrade Dange was one of the founder members of the Indian Communist Party. He formed the Indian Communist Party, and Primitive Communism to Slavery was the book written by him, which represented or which presented Marxist historiography. Subaltern history. The seeds of subaltern history were found in the Marxist historiography. The role of the Italian historian Antonio Gramsci is very important in developing the idea that history should be written starting from the bottommost ranks of the people in the society. The fact subaltern means the bottommost rank. Now the idea of subaltern history was taken from the Marxist historiography itself. The role of Italian historian Antonio Gramsci, is very important in developing the idea that in history should be written starting from the bottommost ranks of the people in the society. So earlier we have seen that it was only to the elite society, you can say, or the creamy layer, like the kings, the scholars, to the or the advisors to the king, or the ministers of the king or the ruler, and the wars and the great warriors. But now the concept of this history changed in the subaltern history, and they felt, on the contrary, that history should be written which should start from the bottommost rank of the people in the society. So it meant to focus on the can say a major contribution of the society, like can say the middle class or the lower class, so called. So it stated that here Antonio Gramsci, he was of the opinion that it should start from the bottommost ranks in the society, because subaltern itself means the bottommost rank. Folklore has been considered as a very important source of writing subaltern histories. Ranjit Guha, an Indian historian, played a major role in establishing subaltern history as an important academic school of historiography. However, we may point out that much before the onset of the subaltern ideology, similar thoughts were expressed by Mahatma Jyotirao Phule and Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. So folklore has been the considered as the very important source of writing subaltern history, and the prominent name was of Ranjit Guha. He was an Indian historian, and he played a major role in establishing the subaltern history as an important academic school of historiography, as an important part of historiography. Ranjit Guha has a major contribution or a major role in establishing subaltern history. But but somehow we can say that much before the subaltern history or the ideology of subaltern history was formulated or came in the forefront, the similar thoughts were expressed by the subaltern history were expressed by Mahatma Jyotirao Phule and Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. Mahatma Phule unfolded the history of the Shudra Atishudra communities in his book Gulam Giri, and he drew attention to the exploitation of women, Shudras and Atishudras done under the name of religion. So Mahatma Phule, he emphasized on the history of the Shudra Atishudra communities in his book Gulam Giri. So he wrote a book Gulam Giri, and he has expressed the history or the treatment given to the Shudras and the Atishudras. He drew attention to the exploitation of women, Shudras and Atishudras done under the name of religion. So taking the name of religion, the Shudras, that is Shudras and Atishudras, the very lower caste which were considered that time. Now everything is, there is a lot of equality, but in those earlier times, in the name of religion, women, the so-called lower castes, were treated very badly. So he has emphasized or he has brought in the forefront the exploitations, the bad treatments given to the women, Shudras and the Atishudras, in the name of religion. The term Shudra and Atishudra indicates the bottommost ranks in the caste system. So Shudras and Atishudras relate to the bottommost rank in the caste system. The role of the people belonging to the Dalit castes is very significant in the shaping of various cultural and political aspects of India. However, their role was not duly acknowledged in the colonial and the nationalistic historiography. Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, focusing on this fact, consistently wrote about it. Two of his books, Who Were the Shudras and The Untouchables, may be cited as examples of history of subaltern type. Now the contribution of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar is also very noteworthy, and he had contributed a lot. So the role of the people belonging to the Dalit castes is very significant, as they contribute a lot in shaping the various cultural and political aspects of India. So if we see the culture and the politics of India, we can see that the contribution of the Dalit castes is great. So they contribute to be a very important part or aspect of our culture. But their role was not acknowledged or given importance to in the colonial and the nationalistic historiography. Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar focused on this fact and consistently wrote about it, and in his two books, Who Were the Shudras and The Untouchables, and these books can be seen as an example of the subaltern type of history. Moving ahead to the feminist history, over a significant period of time, mainly male scholars were involved in the writing of Indian history. As a result, the role and achievements of the women in history remained neglected. To highlight this fact was a major task faced by the feminist historians. Also, it was important to study and compile the historical writings of women. It was also necessary to rethink of women's position in history. Till now, we have seen in both the chapters that we have seen so many European scholars as well, and Indian scholars also, Indian historians, European historians, the Western historians and scholars, but we did not come across any historian or scholar in the female section. So feminist history was the concept which evolved, and mainly it was dominated by the male scholars, and therefore the problems faced by the women or the achievements of the women or the contribution of the women to the society was also not given emphasis on. So the achievement of the woman in history remained neglected. It was not given importance. To highlight this fact was a major task faced by the feminist historians. Now these feminist historians had to give focus on that also, and it was important to study and compile the historical writings of women. So it was important that the importance should be given and the focus should be given to the writings, historical writings of the women. And it was also necessary to rethink on women's position in the history. Among women authors, writings about women in the 19th century CE, Tarabai Shinde was the foremost one. She wrote attacking the male-dominated social system and the caste system. Her book Stri Purush Tulna, published in 1882, is acknowledged as the first feminist book in India. In 1888, the book written by Pandita Ramabai was published, entitled The High Caste Hindu Woman. So the women authors' writings were written in 19th century CE, and Tarabai Shinde was the foremost, the leading lady amongst them, and she wrote attacking the male-dominated social system and the caste system in her book called Stri Purush Tulana, which means comparing the girls or the ladies and the gents, or the males and the females, which was published in 1882, and it is seen as the first feminist book in India. In 1888, a book was published by Pandita Ramabai, and it was entitled The High Caste Hindu Woman. The feminist literature of the post-independence era concentrated on the issues like employment of women, treatment meted out to them at their workplace, their right to political equality, etc. Among the recently published feminist literature, Meera Kosambi's book, Crossing Thresholds, Feminist Essays in Social History, is of importance. It contains essays on the life stories of women like Pandita Ramabai and Dr. Rukmabai, the first practicing lady doctor of India. A lot of literature is available unfolding the viewpoint of Dalit women in Maharashtra. Dr. Sharmila Rege's work is noteworthy in this context. Her book, Writing Caste, Writing Gender, Reading Dalit Women's Testimonies, includes her essays on the autobiographies of Dalit women. So the feminist literature of the post-independence era, like the literature which was written in the post after the independence, focused more on the issues like employment of women, then treatment, how they got the treatment at their workplaces, their right to political equality, etc. And among the recently published feminist literature, Meera Kosambi So among the recently published, like more lately published book written by Meera Kosambi, the book called Crossing Thresholds, Feminist Essays in Social History is of great importance because it contains the essays of the life stories of women like Pandita Ramabai and Dr. Rukmabai. Pandita Ramabai and Rukmabai. Dr. Rukmabai was the first practicing lady doctor of India. A lot of literature is available unfolding the viewpoint of Dalit women in Maharashtra. So later on there were many more feminist historians who had written a lot about the viewpoint or the ideas or the feelings of the Dalit woman in Maharashtra. Dr. Sharmila Rege's work is noteworthy in this context. Her book, Writing Caste, Writing Gender, Reading Dalit Women's Testimonies, included her essays on the autobiographies of the Dalit women. So, Dr. Sharmila Rege's contribution was like through her book, which was entitled Writing Caste, Writing Gender, Reading Dalit Women's Testimonies, which included the essays on the autobiographies. It were essays sort of on the autobiographies, the life stories of the Dalit women. There have been a number of Indian historians who wrote without embracing a particular ideology. Among them, historians like Sir Jagannath Sarkar, Surendranath Sen, Riyasatdar G.S. Sardesai and Trambak Shankar Shezwalkar are noteworthy. Now we have seen, children, that the writings were mostly focused on some other ideology, like Marxist history or subaltern history or feminist history. But then there were few historians who wrote without any particular ideology. Their writings or their literature was not based on any of the ideology. So among them, the historians like Sir Jagannath Sarkar, Jadunath Sarkar, Surendranath Sen, Riyasatdar G.S. Sardesai and Trambak Shankar Shezwalkar are noteworthy. The writings of these people are very noteworthy. They are very great and they are not focusing on a particular ideology as well. In the recent times, historians like Yashwant Dinkar Phadke, Ramchandra Guha, etc. have contributed extensively to the historiography of modern India. Recently, later on, there were writings from different historians again, and these historians have contributed greatly to the history of the modern India. And who were these historians? Few historians like Yashwant Dinkar Phadke, Ramchandra Guha. These were many scholars who have contributed greatly to the history of modern India. Thus, it is evident that the Indian historiography has been influenced greatly by the social and political movements It seems that some part of the Indian historiography was also developed outside the influence of these movements. So in general, we can see that the Indian historiography was influenced by the social and the political movements generally. But some part of the Indian historiography was also developed or has been also written and liked and contributed a lot, which was not influenced by any of these social or political movements. That's all. With this, we come to an end of this chapter. Thank you.